right. As I said, this is our student success workshop. And it looks like there's Eric coming in right now. So Eric logs in. My name is Amanda Zika, and I'm the manager of the First Year Experience Office at Rock Valley. So this is part of our student success workshop series. We're so glad you're here. Hi, Eric.
Hello, everybody. Sorry Hello. About that.
That's okay. I was just introducing myself, and I'll turn over controls to you. You look like you're on a news channel with your title there. I like that.
I go for the extra fancy. Thank you.
I can see that. So we are excited to have Eric Woulfe with us today from the CIS, Computer Information Science Department. And so I'm going to turn over the floor, and we're excited to get some Microsoft skills today. So Eric, I'll be here if you need me as usual, and just yell at me if you need me to jump in, but okay. I'll turn over the floor. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you. And I will grab for screen sharing here. You'll have to forgive me, guys. I usually don't do all of this from a regular PC. I usually do this from a Mac, and this feels totally weird and foreign to me. So I thought it would be best to do it where probably you guys will see things. Can you see like my whole desktop and a little bit of a cheesy paper here? I get a couple of head shakings. Yes, that is perfect. So today I just wanted to cover a couple of kind of hidden, really brief, but really advantageous tips to kind of help make finals not so bad. I can say this as an instructor because I remember what it was like as a student and I know what I put you guys through. Finals can really be a lot. So any way we can make it so that you can save some time, save a little bit of aggravation, and really kind of focus your attentions where they should be, which is actually producing the material, producing the work, as opposed to just sweating your way through the details. I think that that is for the better. So what I have here is we've got two things open, and I'm going to flip back and forth a little bit between kind of two versions of Microsoft Office. All of you as Rock Valley college students have access to both it's called Office 365 Pro Plus, which is the version that you would install on your local machine. So whether or not that is a PC or a Mac, you would have access to that. If you're on the Chromebook side, you're going to be stuck with, but that's okay. You're going to be stuck with Office 365 or office.com, really the online version. So what hopefully you guys can see here is the online version. You would just go to office.com. I can't sign in while we're doing this because you would actually see all sorts of student papers, which I think probably FERPA would explode. So you would sign into office.com with your S number at student.rockvalleycollege.edu, and you would have full access to what you see here, which is Microsoft Word Online. The first tool we're going to take a look at, though, is right here with the regular version of Microsoft Word. So what I've done here, this probably won't happen on your machines, but I wanted to make a really big visual distinction between the two. So where you see a screen with white, like you do right here, that one is the local version of Microsoft Word. So the one that you would have to actually install. When you see the version with the black background, we'll get that back over here. The version here with the black background is the office.com version. You probably won't see it this way. I switched the office.com version to dark mode so that we get a really powerful visual cue that I have switched from one version to the other. So we will come back here to the Office Online version, but we'll spend our first little bit here with the regular Office, so the one that you will have installed on your computer. So what I have is just a bit of a generic document here that I kind of threw together really quickly. I just was in a class last night. We were talking about SQL injection. So I threw that here on the paper. And don't worry, none of this has to make any sense to you. It's just so that we have a little bit of content here. So first and foremost, once we get all of our writing done, so what I'm trying to do is stay away from any kind of style here, because I know that for each one of your classes, your instructor is going to have a different set of rules that govern, you know, what has to be on the cover page, what has to be the formatting. Do we have to have Times New Roman? Does it have to be a certain size? So that kind of stuff I'm going to leave to you guys. I just wanted to highlight a couple of tools that help make the process here easier for you. So the very first tool I want to highlight is over here on the right-hand side. We have in the home row, so in the upper left, we have File, Home, Insert, Draw. This is the home row. If I click on Home and then all the way over on the right-hand side, almost all the way over on the right-hand side, we have Editor. What this is going to do is give us an overview of kind of the readability, the sense kind of what our paper is. So I will tell you honestly, I just went and banged this out really quickly. I didn't spend a ton of time, you know, trying to make it sound better. I was just stream of consciousness writing this here, and it says editor score 86%, which means it's okay. So I'm going in the right direction. Here I can click on spelling. You can see I don't have any spelling or misspellings, but if I was to come through here, for example, and just mistype something, I can tell you I mistyped executed before. That would be highlighted in the way that we're accustomed to, with the little red squiggly lines underneath there. If there were any grammar mistakes, I went through and fixed those. It looks like I did okay. We would see if we clicked on grammar, we would see that there might be grammatical errors. Those would be things like having there, and there mistakes. So if was it the T-H-E-R-E versus T-H-E-Y apostrophe R-E, all those kinds of things you can fix from here. And I know that those are regular common tools that you can get to, you know, without having to really dig for them. But the formal writing piece here, you can see I've got a little drop-down box. We can change this from formal to professional to casual. What that will do is actually kind of provide a scheme for Office. In this case, it is for Word. It will provide a scheme for Word to figure out how your language should sound. So for business classes, for example, they should have a professional writing format. What this is going to do, and that ups my score. What this is going to do is change the grammar and change the formatting for things so that things, for instance, are in past tense as opposed to present tense, whereas formal writing, I think, focuses more on present tense than past tense. So you can see that kind of stuff right here with professional writing versus, and I'll just click on it again, formal writing. You can see that drops the score a little bit there. Clarity, if I was to click on that, it would go through and try and help me identify places that can be more clear. So here it doesn't like what's called passive verb, so be executed. I didn't know how else to say that. I could change that from right here. Conciseness, if I was not being concise, it actually looks like I was. I was trying to mess this up for you guys too, and it just appears that I know what I'm talking about for SQL injections, which is a surprise, honestly, to me at this point. But at any case, you can come through here and click on any one of these refinements, and it will give you, Word in this case, will give you an indication of what might be changed. So this way, when you've already come through, you've already made your, you know, you've come through and you've made your point with what the paper has to do. On the home row, right up here in the upper left, and then editor over here on the right-hand side, you can go through and make those, you know, necessary improvements that otherwise we would have had to, you know, think a little bit further ahead and maybe have the writing center, et cetera, help us out with. Because I know everybody does these a week in advance, never ever the night before things are due under the sheer panic of the clock ticking away at you. So this kind of baked in tool certainly gives you, a pretty great way to make sure that your papers sound even better. I'll tell you, I, you know, take classes myself, and in the kind of the 20 years that has intervened between when I was you guys in a classroom and now when I'm taking classes again, I kind of let my formal writing persona die off. I really don't write a whole bunch of stuff anymore like this. So I use these tools a ton because they really help me switch from, you know, teacher speak in things to writer speak for things. And that's been a really big help. Now, I just want to highlight a couple more things. So when you're actually writing the paper, I know, because I have students and I know from being a student, not everybody thinks best when they have to think and type things at the same time. I actually, you know, because, and this might be because I am an instructor, but I actually think my way through these problems, these kinds of papers, for example. I think these things through better when I am talking them out. I know it's called the OWL Writing Lab, O-W-L. We use it here at Rock Valley. I've been using it as an online resource, you know, for about 1,000 years now, it feels like. And one of the writing techniques that the OWL Lab suggests is to type and talk your way through your paper. And I find that that's a little bit slow, and I like for that process to be smoothed out a little bit. So while I'm in here, I'm going to go ahead and just click after any one of my paragraphs in here, and I will add a space so that I can start a new paragraph. And two over from your editor button in the home row is dictate. And I write papers, I write pages in Canvas, in Eagle when I'm putting things together for students. I actually do this when I respond to student emails. I tend not to type things. I tend honestly to talk them out. And for me, this goes a bunch faster. As long as you have a microphone, so it's probably covered up here, you know, by my email address, it appears. But as long as you have a microphone, so the one that is built into your laptop, if you have, this is a not so great $20 microphone that I think sounds just fine. As long as you have one of these connected to your computer, you can use Dictate. All you have to do is click the button, and hopefully it's not going to go ahead there. That's perfect. And grab this away from our Zoom meeting. That would be less than ideal. But what you can do here is simply talk your way through what you want to express in your paper. Word, with that dictate function, is going to go through and worry about adding things like punctuation. It's going to worry about things like spelling. It's going to worry about things like uppercase and all of those things that take, at least for me, that take bandwidth away from what I want to do on the paper. And it simply automates that whole progress or process rather for you. So I'm going to go ahead and stop that. So you can see I've got this paragraph here, and it went through and it dictated everything, but it did not add the punctuation. So I can tell you that probably won't happen on all of yours. I'm using something to block Word from going and adding things to Word Online, which is actually where it goes and it grabs all those punctuation marks from, because I want my video here to not stutter out. When I tested this before, it was adding the punctuation marks, but honestly, it's not that hard to go back through afterwards and add the punctuations where you would need to. It's certainly a lot faster than it is, you know, trying to do all of those in place while you are typing. Next, one of the things I know, it took me a while to learn, and one of the things I know that I repeat to students a lot, and that they have responded with a lot of, you know, benefit from this, is to read what you wrote, not to read what you think you wrote. So when all of us go back to edit our papers, we kind of give ourselves the benefit of the doubt, and that's not necessarily always a good thing. I know I wrote a fantastic paper, as evidenced by me having written a paper, right? So we all kind of do this. And a great way to edit your paper is to actually hear Microsoft, in this case, Microsoft Word, read that paper back to you. So if we click over here at the, there's our home row again. If we click over here on the view menu, you will actually see the immersive reader. And I, of course, there we go, have lost temporarily the immersive reader. It is, for me, it is the six from the left-hand side, and it says immersive reader. So I'm going to go ahead and highlight a paragraph really quickly, or a bunch of bullet points here really quickly. And then once I click on immersive reader, it is going to give me the reader view here. And what that'll do is get rid of all the formatting. It'll get rid of everything else so I can focus just on reading what I wrote. You can take this a step further by clicking on read aloud, and it's actually going to go ahead and do that. So it is probably, I am hoping at any rate you guys cannot hear it. It is reading it aloud over here where my speakers are, and I can hear everything that is going on. That really does tell me, you know, in an auditory format, which I learn better at, but it tells me what it is that I was writing, and it makes it sound the way that my audience is going to read it, or the way that my audience is going to hear it, and it helps me identify if I've used language that is in fact clear and concise, or if I need to go back through and change my language so that it's easier for the audience to be able to actually get what I needed them to get out of my paper. So the very last tool in here before we switch over to sheer magic, the very last tool in here, and it's one that I struggle with a ton, is citations. That I will tell you that next to like learning colors and geography, learning how to do proper citations was never something that I was any good at. And I totally, totally stink at it now, even now. And I think that the baked-in tools here have saved me thousands of hours and probably helped me earn degrees as opposed to just fail out of them. I know there's value in providing references. I don't mean to distract from that, but if you click here on references in the home row, what you can do is select what kind of references it is that you are supposed to do. So the default format here is APA, but there is Chicago, there is MLA. And again, the instructor that you have is going to have an influence on what kind of citation you have to provide. So here you can select from that. The default is APA, and frankly, I'm not sure how well used that is here at Rock Valley, because all of us instructors have our own peculiar preference for that. And I will tell you, I have memorized exactly zero of what the APA formatting style guide is, and you don't have to memorize this either. What you can do is, so I'm just any place inside of my document. I'm clicking on a blank line now, but it doesn't particularly matter. What you can do is insert citation. So again, on the home row, this is in the references tab. And it's here roughly a third of the way from the left-hand side is insert citation. So what I want to do, you can see I've already added one here for Port Swinger on my SQL injection attack paper. And what I want to do is add a new source. So from here, you can select what kind of source it is that you are adding. This was my biggest issue. Is it a book? Is it a journal? Is it like from a scholarly report? So for us in IT, this would be called a white paper, an electronic sort, etc. And the website citations always goofed me up. So I'm just going to go here for website citation. And what we're going to do is we're going to add really quickly a new website citation so that we can add automatically our bibliography when we are done. So I'm going to go here back to this is just my browser. And right here, I have CrowdStrike, which is it's a security feature website. They actually do traffic management stuff. So this is what I would consider an industry standard. So right here, I can see that this was published October 10 of 22. So I need to know that little piece of information. I'm going to come back here to my Word document, and I am going to click on corporate author. And this is CrowdStrike. I can't type and talk at the same time. There we go, CrowdStrike. So I have the corporate author. The name of the web page is, I'm just going to copy this. So SQL injection, which we don't have to know anything about. So I'm going to paste the name of that into my name of website. Web page rather, name of website. I can copy the entire URL from here and I can paste that in here. Year, we said this was 22. Month, we said this was October. Day, we said this was the 22nd. And then I can paste that URL in here again. And as soon as I hit OK, you can see I've got this little footnote in there, and that will get pushed down as long as I need for it to. I can also actually delete this if I wanted to, because now that I have two sources cited in that automatic citation generator, what I can do is click on this little drop down, and again, this is about a third of the way through. I know it's hard to see, a third of the way through from the left hand side under manage sources and APA style is bibliography. So some instructors require a bibliography, others require simply listing of references, others require works cited. These, all of them have different and peculiar rules that I, as the author, don't have to memorize, which again is fantastic. I can just click on bibliography and it creates for me a bibliography section. All of the indentation is correct. The order in which the required materials here is automatically formatted for me. I can come through here. I'm just going to go ahead. And if I right click, I can say new page. Otherwise, I can do it the old fashioned way. And I'm going to do that here. I've got the wrong kind of keyboard. I can push my bibliography down to the right page, which is the last page. And I didn't have to do anything in order to do this. If I was to do this with books, with scholarly articles, etc., it really doesn't matter. Word is going to format all of this for me. So, any questions so far on all these great tools that Word builds in for us? So far, that's a no. That's fantastic. What we'll do from here, I just want to switch over to, there we are, switch back over here to this is Word Online. So again, you do have, as Rock Valley College students, you have the opportunity to go ahead and download the full desktop version, whether or not that's for a Mac or a PC, the full desktop version of Office depending on what you need, it's probably Office 2019. It's the automatic download. Otherwise, it's called Office 365 Pro Plus. It's almost essentially the same thing. You also can come here to office.com. Remember to sign in with your S number at student.rockvalleycollege.edu. So you do need that whole email address to sign in. This you do need to do from office.com. What I'm about to demo is number one, magic, is number two, fantastic magic, and number three only works on office.com. So this is the exact same paper. I have just copied and pasted it into an Office 365 Word document. Now, you could have produced the rest of this document right from here in office.com or office365.com in this case. The problem is if I click on references, you actually don't get access to that same reference generator that is just with the desktop version of Office. So this tool is just in the online version. I personally don't enjoy that I have to show you two different tools. However, it is 100% totally worth it. So here I have my document is named. So SQL injection attacks, you can see that in the upper left hand corner. Here I've got all the exact same content with the exception of the stuff I dictated into that local document. And all I did was take my document, I copied it, and I pasted it here into Office Online. I will tell you, honestly, I do this exact trick all the time. Just this very week, we had to do a report for a grant we were writing for the CIS department. And this is my feeling. The people who read our reports don't always read the report. So they have to ask for a PowerPoint presentation that goes along with it. And so that makes me write two separate things. At least I used to have to write two separate things. Now all I have to do is write my report in office.com using artificial intelligence, which is magic. And number two, fantastic magic, will turn that into a PowerPoint presentation for me. So here from the home row, and you can see that again, file, home, insert, and layout. So here from the home row, if I say file and export, here I can select export to PowerPoint presentation. This is where the magic happens. I don't have to do much of anything. So I'm going to go ahead and click on export to PowerPoint presentation. This is going to take a little longer than it'll take for you guys because I'm restricting this website from chewing up too much traffic. I'm going to click on see more themes because I want to see more themes. And you can see I can kind of drag left and right and go through this big presentation template stuff. So I'm going to pick this one, the lower right-hand corner. It looks professional enough. You can see already in that design idea number 12, you can see already it says SQL injection attacks. That's the name of my document. It is already pulling things from my document into just the preview so that we can see what the automatically generated by artificial intelligence PowerPoint presentation is going to be. So I'm going to pick this one, design idea 12, and just click on export. This is going to take just a moment, and it's going to say, yay, your presentation is ready. I have this exact same level of excitement. Yay, my presentation is ready. Moments later, I get a fully featured PowerPoint presentation based on the content of my Office document. And I didn't have to do much of anything because the enemy of progress when it comes to everything in academics, which is us here at Rock Valley College, the enemy of progress is a blank white page, right? Because there is all this infinite possibility and the only one that has any control over it is us. It's you, it's me. And that puts a lot of pressure on you. When you do this, export as PDF, you've already done the work and Microsoft AI does the rest for you. So when I click on my slides, it has automatically generated for me slides. You can see here, types of SQL injection attacks, and it's got things that it's grabbed from my paper here in my document. There are a number of different types of SQL injection attacks, and it's gone ahead and it's converted that language into PowerPoint speak. It has given me bullet points, and I don't have to do this myself, which is great. Here, it even gives me the very last page of my automatically generated by artificial intelligence from office.com PowerPoint presentation. It gives me the conclusion with what we would need, and I don't have to recreate any of the work that I've already done to make my paper. I don't have to recreate that work to create a PowerPoint presentation. I can allow Microsoft Word to summarize my document for me. And now I can come through here, and if I'm not, you know, particularly pleased with any of the language, if I want to change the way that things look, on the right-hand side here, there's a designer feature. You can go through here and, you know, add pictures, and Microsoft will automatically select pictures based on your text that it thinks that you are going to look for. That's fantastic. From here, I can change any of these, you know, any of the slides or any of the bullets on the slides. I can change these. So if I want to say pre-prepared, if I think that that's more clear, which in this case I don't, but there it is, I can make those changes from here. And all of that goes ridiculously quickly. It, again, removes from you the onus, the responsibility from starting from scratch, because you've already produced all of the content you need to. Just allow the tool, which is Word, in this case, Word Online, so from Office 365, use the tool to summarize that for you and go ahead and produce for you the presentation. Now, the very last thing to mention here is there are times where because of the way you have to submit your projects to Eagle, and again, this is going to be very, very dependent on what the instructor is looking for. The instructor might be looking for a PowerPoint presentation. They might be looking for an Office Online link. They might be looking for a PDF copy of this to make it easier for them to grade. Over here, again, we're on the home row, so I'm clicking on File. If you click on Share this document, you can invite other people to the presentation. That's going to give you an Office document link. And with that link, you can submit that to your instructor. I do this actually when I make these PowerPoint presentations as an instructor. I get the embed code, so I can put this right into Eagle. You might not find that is, you know, today, April of 2023. You might not find a ton of use for that now, but someplace later on down the road in your career, being able to embed one of these presentations into a website, into an email, into another document that perhaps you're going to, you know, share as part of your, you know, duties in your career, being able to embed this is fantastic. So sharing this document is super easy inside of office.com. I just go back to the home row and File and say Share. Share with people gives me a direct link that I can share, so a URL. And embed allows me to place this presentation inside of another document. So inside of a web page, inside of an email, inside of even a PDF, if you were going to go that route to be able to share that. So there are fantastic tools baked into the versions of Office that you have access to as students. So the primary tools we've talked about here, and I'll go back to our local copy of Microsoft Office. So this is the one that you would have to install on your Mac or on your PC. And again, you're not totally out of luck if your primary computer is a Chromebook. I know a ton of students have that. I enjoy the cost reduction of having a Chromebook, but the problem is there's no really good full-featured version of Office. The good news on a Chromebook is you do still have access to Office online. So the tools we talked about here in our desktop version of Office, in this case, it is Word for Office. The first was, if we click on Design, I was wrong. If we click on Home, that's where I was looking for. Over here on the right-hand side, we have Editor, which is still open for me here. The Editor is like the little green and little red squiggles that we would get as part of our normal document editing experience. This is like that on steroids. It gives us the ability to investigate language changes, make sure that our document is formatted professionally or formally or even informally, and gives us a bunch of really great tools to edit our document very, very quickly so that it's the best version of itself. From there, Dictate. So this again is on that home row, almost all the way over on the right-hand side. If you find that you are better able to communicate what it would essentially be your writing as speaking, that is absolutely something that you can do here in newer versions of Office, specifically Microsoft Word. So click on Dictate, and as long as you have a microphone on a laptop or an actual physical microphone, you know, for a laptop or other, you can simply talk your way through your paper and then go back and format it if need be. This should have done the capitalization, the periods, the commas, things like that. But again, I have that disabled here on my version to make sure I don't hang up on you all in Zoom. The very final thing we did here was under references. We can manage sources and we can manage the style. That allows us to essentially, in shorthand, include references for our paper without having to worry about the formatting for that. What's underlined? What has a comma? What has a semicolon? Who knows? I don't. So use these tools, add the information as a citation here. And then when you're done, you can simply add bibliography and Word will do the formatting for you. The very final thing we talked about was over here on Office 365, was once you have the material for your paper done, you can copy it and paste it, or you can upload it to your OneDrive in, you know, your student at rockvalleycollege.edu account. So either way works. From there, you would go to File and then Export, and you can export your completed document as a mostly completed PowerPoint presentation without having to go back through and recreate the wheel. These five little tips put together can save you a ton of time and aggravation when it comes to, you know, successfully completing here in the last month of school, all of those big final projects, those big final presentations on your way to successfully completing finals for Rock Valley College. So any questions? That's a bunch of no, that's good. Everybody's hungry, that's okay too.
On here, lots of good information. So I know we had some staff on too, so everything's always very helpful for us, Eric. Thank you for attending today. If you have any questions, I know Eric has his email on the Zoom screen.
It's right
as
there,
well.
Big as could be on there.
Yeah, thank you. If you think of anything else, you can always email after. And we appreciate your time, Eric. Lots of good helpful tips.